within our organization to start the session and to please moderate it. Vignesh.
Thank you, Jaya. And let me just get directly into the topic. First, why is this topic? So why did we choose this topic and Interpol for the internet? One fine morning on 7th of July 2007, I received this email, like, emergency, I need your urgent help from my guide, from my supervisor, saying that she's stuck in Nigeria and she needs $2,200 to come from back from Nigeria to India. I was really worried and I was about to send her the money. Then I called her up, her mobile number, and I found out it's not her. She is very well within India. Somebody has hacked her account and they have been sending these kind of emails to so many her friends, all of her contacts in the address book. So then she complained it to the local police, and they were not in a position to track who did the crime. And on the first day, like the moment she complained, they took the monitor and they kept it on the police station. This is a crime investigation division of India. Then I know some basic methods to track cybercrime. So I used a very simple technique and find out. That guy is sitting in Nigeria and his IP address is 41.205.174.90. And his domain name comes from netcoming.com and its ISP is Afrinic. So I gave all the details and the police response was, oh, it's from Nigeria, we can't do anything, we are closing this case. That's it. So now the question arises, whom do I complain? If I'm a victim, like my somebody is impersonating me, then whom, like, do I have to complain to the police who doesn't have a capacity to investigate a cybercrime? And do I need to complain it to the ISP, Afriknik? How do I communicate with them? Or is there any other body that could look into this issue? So now the question arises, whom to complain? Who would investigate? Now, whether Indian government is going to set up a body which would investigate a case in Nigeria, or we need to complain it to the Nigerian authorities. So then the question of sovereignty comes in to the picture. Then who would try the case? Would Nigerian government try the case, or the Indian government would try the case? Where would be the correction mechanism? Whether the person who is sitting at Nigeria, will he be punished according to the Indian Act or the Nigerian Act? Or does Nigeria has an IT Act or not? So these are the questions that comes to immediately, like when we think of cybercrime. So now I would like to invite our panelists, Mr. Bhavan Tukkal, who is the Advocate Supreme Court of India, and he has attended more than 900 conferences all across the globe and shared his enriching experience with the global audience, and he has been part of different cybercrime groups. And our next panelist is Mr. Deepak Makeshwari, who is the Director, Corporate Affairs, Microsoft India. And he has very long-standing experience in this domain, back to he was the part of ISPAI for the past 10 years, and now he is with Microsoft. And we are supposed to have our panelist Alaaluddin Jekadeen from ISAC Ambassador to IGF, and we are expecting his arrival, and we are expecting Rajesh Akarwal from NICSI. So now I'd like to invite our panelists to address these questions. Where do we differentiate between cyber law and real law? What are the IT policies in various developing countries? Is it possible to have one common set of guidelines and policies for all nations? If online crimes mirror offline crimes, then which country's jurisdiction prosecutes? If we think we need a global governing body like an Interpol for the internet, then what are the challenges we need to address? Do we have to look at security versus sovereignty, security versus openness, and security versus freedom of expression? Now I would like to invite Mr. Pavan Tukkal to share his views on this topic. Sure. I would like to invite Mr. Deepak Mageshwari.
Thanks, Gimneshwar, and good morning to all of you. I would just like to start with something based on today's newspaper. So today's newspaper, this is the Economic Times, which is the leading financial business paper in India. And at the bottom, there's a news item here. Some of you might be able to read it, but let me just read the headline here. The headline says, Babu's webmail casualty in anti-terror drive. Now, everybody's already familiar with what type of tragic events happened last week in the country. But the point that is mentioned in this particular news item is this, that government officials in general, and I would say more specifically law enforcement officials, for the official communication, there's a direction from the government of India that they should avoid using webmails. So fine, everybody can have and would have and do have webmails, but they should use the official email IDs for official communication. And this is something very relevant and interesting to consider in the current context. Let's say if there's any type of investigation happening and any of the service providers receive a communication, it could be a phone call, mail, fax, in whatever manner, that, okay, please provide me information of such and such customer or such and such email ID or such and such account. Now, if that particular communication itself is coming, if it is coming from a government official, let's say on a letter, then you know, yes, there's a certain logo, et cetera, and then there's some way to establish that, yes, this really belongs to such and such government official. If this is a particular phone, then, and especially if it is a fixed line phone number, again, there's a way to go about and check whether that particular phone number belongs to that particular agency or not. And after that, suppose the response is needed fast, it would typically require certain data and certain text type information, and the response request itself is, please send to my such and such web ID. Now, how does the respondent ensure few things? Number one, that who is the person who is sending this request? Is that person really the official who that particular communication is trying to convey that, yes, I am official such and such of such and such place? Secondly, is that particular person authorized to do this type of investigation or seek such a communication? And thirdly, then the next level is the type of information which is asked. I think this is something also very important, that we also need to be clear about what type of information that we want, even when any sort of investigation happens. Typically, a request may come that, okay, for such and such account or such and such ID or such and such IP address, please provide all details. Now, this all details is a very wide-ranging aspect. So all details could be all sorts of emails. It could be all type of IP addresses that you might have assigned to a particular customer. It could be in terms of date and time stamping, whole lot of other things. So unless there's a clarity about what is needed, in what context it is needed, and what is the specific type of information that is being sought, it becomes much easier for the respondent to cooperate in such manners. And now let me just go back to some of the broad issues that Vigneshwar just started with. She said about cyber law and real law, and we keep talking about the virtual world and the real world. But the fact is that the cyber law is also a law, and it's a real law. So I would say that cyber law is one of the real laws. So that's one thing. Second thing is, can we have a common law across all over the world? I would say that that's a hypothetical situation. It may be, it may not be actually feasible, because every individual sovereign state will have its own legislation. At the same time, there's scope and there's momentum towards harmonization of cyber law across different jurisdictions, because people are realizing, and especially the government and lawmakers themselves are realizing, that unless they have harmonization, along with mechanism and framework for cooperation, it is very difficult to actually implement a cyber law in a cross-border type of situation. And in most cases, there will be some element of cross-border nature whenever there's a cyber crime situation. And then he was mentioning whether there should be a global governing body per se. And again, here what happens is if we are looking for a global governing body for a particular set of crimes, I think that again becomes a challenge. However, there are models which are available and which people can look at, either for adoption, ratification, or partial implementation, depending on their own respective needs, presence of the basic cyber law within the country, presence of the people, and also in terms of the maturity of the organization and its people to deal with those issues. And in that context, if you see, Interpol, for example, already has a very active engagement on cyber crimes. Of course, Interpol as an intergovernmental organization can do only so much, because unless there's a local legislation and framework within individual nation states which have a mechanism to use the Interpol network, and here I'm not saying in terms of the physical network per se, but I'm saying the Interpol mechanism in totality, then it becomes a case that yes, this is something which is useful, which is something which they can actually go ahead and use. And the type of example that Vignesh just mentioned in terms of the Nigerian thing. So you mentioned, for example, that using the little bit of IP trace and other things, he realized that the person was sitting in Nigeria. Now let's take a case. Suppose there's an ISP in Nigeria. ISP might have given a IP address to somebody in Nigeria. And if there was an access point, or there could be some other sort of wireless access in Nigeria, close to an international border, the person who would be accessing that particular thing could even be outside Nigeria. So that's one thing. Because of, especially in the wireless space, we need to be cognizant of this. And at times those things are possible even in the physical space. For example, in India itself, there are licenses which are for internet services which are geographically restricted. So of course, yes, there's a national license, but there's also a state or a city license. So if somebody has a license only for Hyderabad, and if that service provider is at the Hyderabad's border, puts up a tower, and the signal does cross the borders, because the wireless signals are like clouds and birds, they don't recognize the physical geographical boundaries. And in that sense, if the signal goes across Hyderabad to a neighboring district, the subscriber could actually be sitting in that district. So these types of things are possible, whether in an international, within the country, within a city, within a state, or for that matter, within a home or a building, any such, or a room in that sense. So if you look at some of the models which are available, I would say that Interpol itself has a tremendous amount of network in terms of support and active engagements. There's also FIRST, which is the organization which represents all the CERTs, which is Computer Emergency Response Team. Of course, they don't come directly in the criminal investigation, but that's again something where national governments as well as others do take resort to, especially for widespread attacks and other type of things. And then, of course, we do have a few models such as the Council of Europe's Cybercrime Convention, which has been ratified by many of the countries. In fact, yesterday we heard that even a country like Sri Lanka, which passed its cyber law only in 2007, it got notified in July this year, is also going to ratify the Treaty of Cybercrime Convention of the Council of Europe. And so that treaty part is separate, because that's again a very government-to-government type of engagement. But I think something else that the Council of Europe has done within that overall framework, that they developed guidelines for the cooperation between law enforcement and service providers against cybercrime. And these were approved formally by the Council of Europe on 2nd of April this year. So now it's been about 8 months. This is something where they say what is the objectives, what are the obligations and the rights of the law enforcement agencies, what are the rights and obligations of the service providers, and how to actually go ahead. And this is a very prescriptive but a very comprehensive set of guidelines. I have a copy, and I do understand that probably some of the folders of Council of Europe are about to be circulated by the organizers. That's what I was told by somebody in the morning, and I got one of these. And here, that in case there's something where you do require details from a service provider, typically, you first, who's the authority? So there should be a clear procedure, there should be clear information in the public domain, and specifically to the service provider that, yes, these are the officials at these at such and such levels who can seek such and such type of information. And second is, what type of information, what information that you're asking, and what is the information that you would be giving? So if somebody just says that, okay, this is a customer's name, and please give me the details, that may be very difficult in a country like India, where, or for that matter, many other countries, where the same name, you could have multiple subscribers with the same name. So is there something additionally that you have? Things like, let's say, a particular ID, a particular phone number, a particular mail address, or something like that, which is a different level of identifier, and which is unique, at least as far as the service provider is concerned. And then you look at the next steps. Who's the authorized? Is there a standard template in which you can seek communication? Not for everything you would require response by immediate fax or immediate mail. In some cases, you might have a lead. You may have some time, maybe 1 hour, maybe 1 day. In certain other cases, probably you'll want a response in few minutes. So if the expectations are set out in this type of interactions right in the beginning, in a calibrated manner, that this is the particular type of case, this is the type of communication that we are sending to you, we are authorized. So for example, if somebody receives a communication from somebody who gets that such and such mail ID, can I actually check whether this particular email ID does belong to such and such officer, or a phone number or such thing in a publicly available information? And then, what is the specific information that you are looking? Are you looking for the IP address given to such and such person? Are you looking for the particular content of such and such person? Are you actually looking for the date or time or the point or place of access? So what are the specific type of communication or the details that you are actually looking? And if there's a detailing of that nature, it becomes much more easier for the service providers to actually go ahead, look into the details, and respond in a timely and efficient and effective manner back to the law enforcement agencies. Otherwise, the challenge is always of this nature that, and this I'm talking within a particular country, and just think about the type of case that he was telling, that if it is a cross-border type of jurisdiction. So cross-border jurisdiction, obviously, if you approach a service provider from anywhere else, typically there won't be any response. So obviously one should use the networks like Interpol or maybe bilateral or multilateral agreements to approach through the law enforcement agencies of the other country. And the other country will take interest only if there's a reciprocity. So if there's a country X from where there's a request to a country Y, a country Y would be in a position to help, come ahead and help in that type of investigation only when they also have a reasonable expectation or experience, or at least perception at that stage that yes, in case they require something similar, they would also receive similar type of cooperation and response from the other country. And this brings us to the next point, that is, the in practical terms, the maturity level, either in terms of the legislative framework, or secondly in terms of the capacity building, in terms of the judiciary, the law enforcement, and the prosecutors, and thirdly, in terms of the socio-cultural context of that particular country. This, of course, will differ significantly. And unless people are sensitized in these types of matters, having a new type of mechanism per se would not be very helpful. Thank you. can shift the camera slightly. You can shift it beyond the screen. Thank you. Yeah.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Almost a decade back, there were some huge headlines in India. Those were early days, speeds were less. The level of development of computers were also less. But apparently, well, it all pointed about some kind of primitive cyber attacks from a neighboring country on some government systems here. That news came and faded off. 1999, the Kargil War took place between India and Pakistan, a time that was rampant with a huge accompanying cyber war. We used to have dedicated cyber war attacks from Pakistani systems and Pakistani hackers on Government of India networks, including Ministry of External Affairs, Ministry of Defense's websites. They were constantly being brought down. An acknowledgement that never happened in the public domain. But then there was a problem. Should the Indian government register a case? Their sources were all coming from across the border. Now, people who were doing it were not hackers. In the eyes of India and Indian laws, they were hackers because they were hacking into Indian websites located on Indian computer systems and servers. But across the country, across the border, they were not hackers. They were patriots who were fighting a national war. So at a time when different countries have different perceptions of how to deal with individuals who are dealing with activities impacting computers, computer systems and computer networks, clearly there's a disconnect of how to approach this entire issue of cybercrime. What is cybercrime here may not be a cybercrime in another jurisdiction. Let me give you a classical example. In India, well, you go a couple of 100 miles from here and you come in central India to this famous temple city of Khajuraho. Khajuraho is known for its stone carvings, erotic stone carvings. That's art, a UNESCO heritage site. Is Khajuraho obscene? No, because it's an expression of art. But the Indian law talks about obscenity. The Indian IT law says that if you publish, if you transmit or cause to be published anything in the electronic form, which is lascivious, or which appeals to the prurient interests, or the effect of which is to tend to deprave and corrupt the minds of those who are likely to see, read, or hear the same, that is an offense. Okay, law is very, very clever. It doesn't talk about obscene content. It talks about lascivious. What's lascivious? Appealing to your carnal instincts, or anything which appeals to your prurient interests. Okay, let me give an example. You go to one of the countries in Scandinavia, their pornography is legal. So I, as a citizen of that country, host a pornographic site, a hardcore pornographic site, and I upload it on servers located in that country. What am I doing? I'm a legal entity. I'm doing a legal activity in a legal jurisdiction. There's nothing in illegality in whatever I'm doing. But what I do is I upload my website onto the internet. That website gets viewed here in Hyderabad. And the Indian law says, well, hold on, that's a crime. Well, declaration of crime is one issue. Can the Indian government go ahead and arrest this guy who is doing a legitimate activity in a legal jurisdiction and say, hold on, you've committed a cybercrime? Clearly not. So this is another classical case to show how there are differences of national approaches towards cyber crime. Now, some nations do not, really do not bother about cyber crimes as much. And that was the case of the Philippines in the year 2000. 2000, something magical happened. Look, whenever people get born, they grow young, there's one dominant three words that dominate a portion of the youth. Those three words, magical words, are the I love you. The I love you, almost everybody, anybody has said that in this world to somebody. However, those words had a different connotation. The I love you virus originated from the Philippines, and it is the third most expensive crime in human history, causing more than $10 billion as damage. Now, that virus got uploaded there and then perpetuated to the entire world, crashing millions of dollars worth equipment apart from the intrinsic value of data. But what happened? It was a big crime in the US, so FBI wanted to rush over, and actually rushed over the team to the Philippines. But then they suddenly realized, hold on, Philippines does not have any law which criminalizes the act of sending a virus or the act of sending a worm. So consequently, despite the man being identified and being held, no action could be really taken against him, primarily because at the relevant date, the relevant time, Philippines did not have any law which made that activity as a criminal offense. And it's a fundamental principle of criminal jurisprudence. You cannot, and invariably countries do not, make cybercrime provisions or criminal provisions with retrospective effect. They're always prospective from today onwards. This I love you case once again demonstrated how it becomes increasingly difficult and frustrating for target countries to find the people who are perpetuating their criminal intentions and designs on the computers of their country cannot be targeted. Let me go fast forward and come to 2008. We are now in December. This happens in October, 15th of October. Almost 1 year earlier, a small tiny country by the name of New Zealand enacted a law. This was the Unsolicited Commercial Mails Act of 2007, or in short, the anti-spam law of New Zealand. It was quietly enacted, nobody knew what was happening, and it impacted all computer systems that were located in New Zealand. In a layman's language, what it said was, if you were targeting spam that was focused or that reached a computer system located in New Zealand, you could be held liable for civil liability. Civil liability of paying a fine of $500,000. So that's what the maximum prescribed. No criminal penalty. They said, look, spam is a... We stop shy of giving criminal penalty for spam. This law got enacted, nobody came to know about it. But quietly, spammers were on to the job. December of last year, the BBC, the British Broadcasting Corporation, broadcast a program. This program was an international spam racket, where they said, look, spam was originating. This was a part of a spam racket. They had footprints in New Zealand, in India, in other countries. Well, thereafter, investigations began. And in October this year, the Department of Internal Affairs of the Government of New Zealand actually filed charges for seeking fine of $200,000 against three individuals. Three individuals who have been stated to be the biggest, part of the biggest spam racket that the world has ever known. Things are still going on. We don't know how things will happen, but clearly, once again, a reiteration. Out of these three persons, this guy, the main guy, does not live in New Zealand. The man lives in Australia. And, however, he's still being tried for a fine in New Zealand because his spam hit the New Zealand systems, and therefore the government of New Zealand says that this is ground enough for us to proceed. But there are problems. Well, you know, filing charges is one issue. Getting the guy from Australia to New Zealand is going to be another issue. Is there extradition? Are there some common understandings? We don't know. Will they actually be able to do so? They will have to do so through legal process. Does the legal process allow? These are big questions that actually countries are facing when they are dealing with cybercrime legislations, as also the prosecution and investigation of cybercrimes. It's here that I come to the main subject for the day. Is there a need for Interpol for the internet? I think why this debate has started is primarily because countries are finding that there are huge amount of problems pertaining to how to prosecute criminals, especially those that are located in any other jurisdiction over which your laws do not actually have any impact. I think when the World Wide Web came across in early 90s, nobody ever thought that this initial platform meant for exchange of information could suddenly become a fertile ground, a fertile field for cyber criminals. And therefore, cyberspace and the World Wide Web has now created increasingly new and distinctive legal challenges. I think what has the internet done? It's provided a public space. You know, we take things for granted. Hold on. Where is internet? Where is cyberspace? Is it in this computer? No. Is it somewhere that I can touch? No. Where is cyberspace located? Is it somewhere located in the invisible space over this far wire? No. It's an imaginary concept. I can't touch cyberspace. I can express myself in cyberspace. But if any government wants to say, hold on, I want to arrest cyberspace, you can't do so. But this is a new concept came across, a new concept, that imaginary concept having physical connotations and manifestations, and that became the new public place. The public place where everybody wanted to come in, rather than not just to exchange information, but also to contribute their inputs. And this new connotation has now got a new meaning courtesy Internet 2.0. The social networking has given a new meaning altogether to this cyberspace. Why? Because earlier, people were mere recipients. Internet 2.0 has said users become center stage actors. The users generate content. And that's why the challenges become immense. When you talk about cyber law, a lot of people across the world, when the debate started in the early 90s and the mid 90s, was, hold on, why do we require a new law for cyberspace? We have existing laws. But it clearly became very evident very earlier on that this was a new medium. You were dealing with new challenges, and therefore you require a distinctive set of law or legal study and jurisprudence that was cyber law, that's distinct from the real world law. Of course, different countries have had their own bumpy ride experiences of how to deal with cyber laws. We haven't had a precedent to that. Imagine, you know, anything that we do from the time we are born till the time that we go or we die is something that somebody else has done earlier. Think of it. Your daily activities, your profession, everything that you've done or you do or will do has been done by somebody earlier. It was for the first time countries realized, hold on, this kind of a medium has not existed earlier. The ability to regulate this kind of a medium, there's no previous experience. So consequently, each of them started coming up with their own specific, customized way of dealing with it. The state of Utah in the United States became the first state across the world to enact a cyber law in 1996. Since then, different countries, you had the United Nations, the UNCTAD model law on e-commerce that came along, that was an initial forefront template for countries to adopt. The United Nations allowed and encouraged its member states to adopt that. Consequently, different legislations came across. In a layman's language, what is cyber law? I think cyber law is a law pertaining to the internet, World Wide Web, in cyberspace, and also anything to do with use of computers, computer systems, and networks. Close your eyes and say, is there anything else that cyber law can impact? There's nothing, because at the end of the day, these are the real parameters on which cyber law actually equates. And cyber law, incidentally, is the only relevant legislation that impacts data and information in the electronic form. Developing countries, we are in a developing country. The focus of IGF is on developing countries. But the bad news is developing countries are still in the process of enacting their respective cyber laws. We've had some countries that have impacted and have enacted their cyber laws, like India, Pakistan, Dubai, Singapore, Sri Lanka, Malaysia, Japan, Korea, Philippines. But leave aside them, the vast chunk of developing countries are still groping in the dark how to deal with these issues. And I think what's the problem in this part of the world as far as cyber law legislations is that we have jack-of-all-trade legislation. We don't have dedicated legislations. So is there a dedicated cybercrime law in developing countries? I am actually at complete wits to try to name a country which has a dedicated cybercrime law. No. Yes, you have a jack-of-all-trades law, you have elements of cybercrime, electronic governance, electronic authentication, e-commerce, all things put in, bundled into one package. So that initial bundling is good. But as we go along, we realize that the initial bundling of provisions on cybercrime in these jack-of-all-trade legislations are not holding good. We are falling by the wayside. We do not have adequate legal protection. And I think there is a need for having dedicated legislations on specific topics, which currently is missing in the developing countries. No dedicated legislation on cybercrime. If I was to ask you what kind of cybercrimes exist across the world, then broadly it'll be three main categories. Any and every cybercrime will come in these categories. The first category is cybercrimes against persons, where the target of the criminal activity is against a physical person, whether it's cyber defamation, cyber nuisance, cyber harassment, cyber stalking. You name it and you have it. Anything where the focus is on an individual. The second category is cybercrimes against property, where the focus of the criminal activity is on property, whether it's computers, computer systems, data, information. So hacking and cracking are typical examples in this category. The third is the cybercrimes against nations. This is the third category, which has suddenly sprung up in the last few years, where the focus is on nations. You target nations, whether it's cyber war, cyber terrorism, and the on. So I think different countries have adopted different regulatory and legislative approaches towards cyberspace and cybercrime. The very fact that internet has made geography history has created challenges. Earlier, we were very proud as mankind to have two distinctive subjects, geography, history. But here comes internet, and your geography is history. And therefore, you have huge problems. One common network, one common place, but yes, no physical boundaries. Therefore, where does the jurisdiction of one country start, and where does it end? There are huge jurisdiction issues. And the internet, by its very inherent mechanism, is allowing any person sitting anywhere in the world to target computer systems in any other part of the world and go ahead and do his criminal activities with impunity. And this is a huge jurisdictional challenge that countries are facing. Are countries trying to deal with it? Yes, there is a way this is happening. There's absence of national legislations across conventional physical boundaries. So we have an international treaty in place. This international treaty is the Convention on Cybercrime of the Council of Europe. This is by far the only existing in operation treaty that we have in the world that relates with cybercrime. This treaty, I think, is a good international treaty. Why? It's got more than 45 nations who have already signed on. And these are not nations of the European Union. These nations include the United States, Canada, South Africa, Japan, and now Sri Lanka. So clearly, the world is beginning to encompass this treaty. I think rather than reinventing the wheel, it's a good idea to start on existing work already done and then proceed forward. And therefore, it becomes a single platform for exchange of ideas, strategies, and information pertaining to cybercrimes in the world. I think, where are we moving as internet? We are moving towards ubiquitous computing, ubiquitous internet, where I'm sitting here and from this conference, I want to go back to my home. So I'm going to dial into my home's devices using the internet and the protocol. And I'm going to tell to my coffee machine, have my coffee ready. I'm going to tell to my washing machine, get my things ready and washed up. I'm going to talk to my various devices on my way back as I travel. And by the time I'm done, my coffee's going to be ready, my clothes are going to have been washed across, and it's a different concept altogether. So you are now ceasing to only consider internet as a mere communication mechanism. You are now usually going on to ubiquitous computing, where you're talking to all kinds of entities and physical objects. In that kind of a scenario, I think it's very important that there's a necessity for international guidelines and principles in those kind of scenarios. So it is, therefore, I completely agree with Deepak. It's not possible to expect that all countries will have the same law on cybercrime. No, it will never happen, neither in our lifetimes or never later when we are all gone. So what's the reality? The reality is we need to codify the common international principles, the common jurisprudence pertaining to cybercrime in a common treaty. A common treaty, a common international arrangement, which needs to be approved by nations. Well, nations need to incorporate then those relevant portions and principles in their national jurisprudence, in their national legislations, depending upon what their exigencies are. So I don't know how this is going to happen. Is this going to happen through the Council of Europe Convention on Cybercrime? Is it going to happen through Interpol? It has to happen. Now, or is it going to be some new entity that's going to be formed? Obviously, there are political challenges in acceptance of the Convention on Cybercrime. Why? Because the convention is also strict. It says, hold on, the moment you sign on me, make sure you make changes in your national legislation. Now, that's something that a lot of countries may not want to do. They may still want to retain their national legislations, maybe take the best practices of the Council of Europe, and then have them incorporated. But to have a de novo criminal law in a developing country is a very tall order. For example, let me give you the classical case of India. India has got an Indian penal code. If we are going to try to amend the Indian penal code, we will have to go to all the states. And it's going to be a very, very time-consuming process. It's not going to happen in the next 5 to 7 to 8 years. By that time, cybercrime is going to go off completely. So I think there's a need for an international arrangement in that regard. There's a need of the time is to give jurisdiction to both countries. Look, when, yeah. Yeah. Correct. Correct.
Those 45 countries, how many have passed, you know, legislative enactment in their countries so that it has been ratified by those?
I think I don't have the figures, but I think the ratification figures goes into 20s. So more than 20 or 22 odd countries have already ratified.
They have ratified it.
Ratified, which means that they've already amended their national laws in accordance with this.
So has it become a treaty now? Because
for every convention, the convention itself specifies the number of countries which should ratify it to become legally enforceable.
It,
in this case, has it been, I mean, that convention state has become a treaty or not?
It is already a treaty. It's already in operation, and it's a working platform. So it's no longer a mere, signatures into certain statement of principles. It's effective, it's working. And the best thing is, you suddenly have a common platform where you can start exchanging ideas, and there's a commonality of approach. So now it's not happening between, say, US and Philippines, where US has got a law on worms and viruses, and the Philippines doesn't. And, you know, these are completely uninteroperable devices. So it's happening, and this is the only model that we currently have. One option is, hold on, let's try to rebuild another model. Now, if you do that, it's going to take a lot of time. So better idea is, hold on, let's work on this model. Let's make this treaty less strict. Why is there a need for each country to have the same language? A lot of developing countries may not want to have it. But if you have, in a sense, the principles and the substance of what's given in the treaty in your legislation, I think that should remain good. So that's, I think, that's why I said there are various options. One is it can go through the Convention on Cybercrime route. The other option is, hold on, it can actually go on through the Interpol route. And third is, hold on, there may be a new organization, maybe something that the IGF forms, or maybe something that after the 5 years of IGF, something new comes across. It's too early to predict. But the vacuum of the need exists, and the need needs to be fulfilled the quicker, the better. But I think one thing is very clear, countries are clear. The jurisdiction should not stop a country from taking action. So, for example, in the classical case of the Philippines and the US, where the worm was originated from Philippines, and it targeted US. Typically, the way the world has to move is both the countries should have jurisdiction. Hold on. The country who was targeted, whose systems were targeted, should have equal jurisdiction to try the guy. The country of origin of the criminal activity should also be the country where the jurisdiction should exist. You should not, the criminals should not hide behind procedural thought processes or curtains in order to ensure that, hold on, I don't get convicted. Today, what happens is a cyber criminal does his work and then walks off from that jurisdiction in case if he has got slight apprehension that he may be caught. He goes to another jurisdiction. And that's how what happens. These phishing guys, these are coming up with phishing sites for 5 days. The site is up, then the site is down, on to next jurisdiction. It's a new jurisdiction, new site up for another five, six days, then down. So I think the scenario is this gypsy way of running and of living of the cyber criminals needs to be curtailed. So therefore, multi-jurisdiction is the only way forward that I personally believe. However, you have absence of cyber law and absence of cybercrime legislations in targeting jurisdictions, and that's what needs to be currently addressed. Another big problem the world has failed is we do not have enough numbers of cybercrime convictions. Internet? 1969, ARPANET came across. Early 80s, it got extended to academic universities. Early 90s, the World Wide Web came across. So technically, the internet has been here for the last almost 40 years. 40 years and how many cybercrime convictions across the world? It's not going to be more than a couple of dozen convictions across the world, across countries. Take a country of India, 3 cybercrime convictions in the last 14 years since when internet was commercially introduced in our country. A lot of countries don't have convictions. So if the numbers are not speaking for you, the common populace, the common netizen population has no confidence in the system. They believe, look, the system is incapable of deliverance. And that is why I think a major problem. So I think what we really require is that the world as a whole needs to act against cybercrime. And in this fight, network service providers become very crucial aspects. Today, I believe the network service providers are repositories of data. I was talking yesterday in the main session that people today are vomiting on the internet. Internet is a vomiting basket where people are vomiting everything and anything about themselves, right from their family lives to their sexual encounters to their girlfriends to their professional enterprises or whatever. Hold on. This is not the Facebook that's going to go and walk off tomorrow. This is not the hi-fi that's going to not be with you. This data is going to be archived. Data is going to be visible to you, to your grandchildren, and to your great-grandchildren as time passes by. And very soon you will realize, you'll start actually repenting what you are doing, what you are vomiting on the internet. Now, when that kind of a thing is happening, these network service providers who are providing these services become the repositories of my data. And then these network service providers can have a very crucial role in helping law enforcement agencies as far as the fight against cybercrime is concerned. I think there's a need for an international body to monitor international efforts on cybercrime. This body needs to have international recognition. It needs to have support of nations. We have one body, which is Interpol. Yes, Interpol is also doing some work on the internet. But is it an internet Interpol? No, it's not an internet Interpol. It's an Interpol of the existing world. Do we require a special internet an Interpol for the internet? I think there is a need. It may not be the existing Interpol. It may be some other organization. But there is a crying need for this kind of an organization to come across. Why is this required? Because there's a need for coordinated international approach towards cybercrime. Actually, cybercrime policy creation, drafting, and implementation is the only way forward in your fight against cybercrime. You can't just have an ostrich kind of an attitude and say, I'm going to close my eyes. No, you have to face it right, and you need an international body. How governments of the world take this way forward is something that's left up to the political will. But clearly, the ball is now back to the nation's court. It's time for the nations to take initiatives and create this new body or bestow some powers on some existing international bodies so that cybercrime as a phenomenon is now effectively tackled addressed at the international level, apart from local and national approaches adopted by different countries through their own national legislations. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. It's been a pleasure.
Thanks to the panelists. Like, they have given a really excellent presentation. And I would like to open the floor for discussions now. Excuse me.
I have a question for Pavan. We are talking about cyber laws, and there's a lot of content which is being distributed on mobile. And does the cyber law address this, number one? And I would like to highlight the case of an MMS clip which was distributed on Bazi, and the CEO got arrested and all that. Given a scenario where this MMS clip had been distributed on a Web 2.0 platform, what's the stand? And since there was legal compliance from both the participating parties, how is it brought accountable? Who is brought accountable?
Thank you for that question. I think you raised a very important question that's very relevant from the Indian perspective. First and foremost, are mobiles covered by cyber law? The answer is clearly yes, and it's not just for India, it's for the world. Why? Cyber law deals with computers, computer systems, and computer networks. In any definition of any legislation or cyber law across the world, the way a computer has been defined, it has been defined in broad terms to include any device which has got mechanisms, which has got memory functions, which can data processing capabilities. So your mobile typically is a computer within the law. And Indian law is no exception. It is clearly a computer under Section 2.1 of the Information Technology Act 2000. So the moment you're doing anything with this device, the cyber law is going to be impacting you. That's your first question. Regarding your second point, yes, this is a very valid point. For those of people who didn't know what the background of the question was, 4 years back, in a very prominent public school in Delhi, something happened. A girl, 11th class, 11th girl, was giving oral sex to a classmate. The classmate captured that activity on a mobile MMS. That 2 minute, 37 second mobile MMS, initially meant for private circulation, leaked out in the public domain, and surely became the rage of the times. Everybody who had an MMS capability wanted to see it, had seen it, had forwarded it. Now, initially, it was fun, but slowly, I think, you know, the media got some scent of it. One of the TV channels made it a kind of a daily feature. They had a program saying, hold on, this kind of an obscene activity is taking place. Is the government sleeping? Is it awake? So under a lot of media pressure, the government finally relented and registered a case of online obscenity. Now, for that case, who was to be picked up? Now, that's a problem. While this was happening, something else happened. In an Indian Institute of Technology at Kharagpur, one student picked up this MMS, which was available at the local LAN of the Technology Institute, and put it up on an online auction portal, Bazi.com, which got taken over by eBay and is now eBay.in. And he did not post the MMS. All he posted was, hey guys, you have heard about the famous MMS. If you still have not got it, I can give you at 100 rupees a download. That was the message. Now, he posted that on a Saturday evening, on the 27th of November 2004. That was a Saturday evening. The website was closed. Sunday was holiday. Monday, first thing in the morning, the website came to know that this kind of a message was up. They pulled the message down. But by that time, history had been created. 27 people across the country had downloaded the MMS at 100 rupees a download. For that activity, the CEO of the company who was running the website was picked up, was behind bars for 6 days, and his criminal trial is still continuing. Now, why is that happening is because of a peculiar provision under the Indian law, which says if you are a network service provider, then you are made liable for all third-party data or information made available by you. Only in two conditions you are not liable. One is that you can either show that he had no knowledge of any contravention of the law, or second is that you can show that despite exercise of all due diligence, you still could not prevent the commission of any offense or contravention under the law. So hold on. You know, the onus is on the service provider to prove his lack of knowledge or his exercise of all due diligence. And in this case, the CEO that was arrested was a US citizen, who was an Indian-born guy, but a US citizen working in India. He was picked up. So the matter's gone up. The matter's gone to trial. The government did not relent, filed their charge sheet. The Delhi High Court on a judgment in May this year said, hold on, this charge sheet is fine. You continue with trial. And ask the guy to go to trial. The matter is right now before the Supreme Court. So that's existing law of the land. We don't know what's going to happen in this case. But in this kind of a scenario, if this kind of a clipping was made available on a Web 2.0 setup, maybe any kind of a website, then the law is very clear. The website becomes a network service provider. So the website is going to be held liable, provided there's a complaint. Similarly, yes. Similarly, if somebody is having a cyber cafe, somebody across the road who's having a cyber cafe and who's allowing you to access the internet at 10 rupees an hour, then he also becomes a network service provider and he can also be picked up. And of course, this is the existing law. The government has been under some pressure. We are expected to see some amendments where there will be some modification in this kind of a liability. But clearly, this is the existing position and it has thrown up a lot of challenges. A lot of challenges, especially pertaining to cyber crimes in this regard. Deepak, would you want to add something?
I think one of the important things that we need to look at is this, that much of the service providers are going to be in the private sector, whether providing access, content, or any such thing. And there's a multitude of them. And they're going to be in different jurisdictions. By definition, because the internet itself is cross-border by nature. And in that sense, it is very important for everybody to realize that yes, while there should be criminalization of activities, at the same time, if there are certain other things where the service provider does not have an active role in perpetration or abetting of that type of activity, then there should also be a safe harbor for that particular entity. So let's take an example. Suppose there's a highway, and maybe the highway is very good, unlike the roads here around this place, where you do find a little bit of road in between the potholes. But suppose the highway is very good, and there's a speed limit of 100 kilometers, and the highway authority or the person who is managing it has already mentioned that you don't drive beyond 100 kilometers. Somebody does drive more than 100 kilometers, might hit something, or might be caught. Is that particular authority responsible? Because one can always say that in terms of all due diligence, you should have created enough friction on the road so nobody could have crossed 100 kilometers in a speed. So probably all the road should have been almost like a speed breaker so that you'd never cross that type of speed. Now, is that type of onus should be placed on the service providers on the internet?